Okay, cool. So, Asanka must. Oh, okay, great. Achana and Pooja's here. Fantastic. Great. From BCG and from, I've lost my,
Hot box.
agenda. Okay, so we've got Pooja from ThoughtWorks. Sorry, you said that. Yeah. Pardon me. Okay, fantastic. We'll get straight into it. We're running a little bit late, so I don't want to take up more of your time. Asanka is going to put, just to follow up on that, Asanka will put in the chat the link that to the paper that he was talking about. I'll jump off screen and leave you both to talk us through this. Thanks.
Thanks, Mark. Hello, everyone. I'm Pooja. I'm a developer at ThoughtWorks. Archana is also here with me today. She's the developer at BCG. Today, we would like to quickly walk you through our experience of having built an IoT platform for a large enterprise. And we'll walk you through some of the learnings that we've had and some of the best practices that you could follow if you're building an IoT platform. So we'll start with how we tend to visualize the different components of an IoT ecosystem. So we look at it as different layers constituting this entire stack. The lowest couple of levels would consist of sensors and actuators that translate between the physical quantities of the environment, like temperature, pressure, humidity, and things like that, and your digital data and the applications that can operate with that data. The next level would be adapters and on-premise gateways that would serve as a bridge between the sensors and the actuator data and the cloud applications. The next level would be the various services on the cloud that consume the data provided by these sensors and actuators. And these can also be used to provide commands to the different actuators on the premise. And finally, the consumer applications like the mobile or the web applications that you would typically use to control these devices, that forms your last level. Now, in this talk, we'd like to concentrate a bit more on the cloud layer, where we have worked extensively on. Now, to start off with, just considering as an example, let's consider one of the use cases where there's a hotel chain management and they want to optimize their energy savings in their hotels. So they want to what they wanted to do was to put in place automated mechanisms, like, for example, regulate the temperature in the hotel rooms based on the occupancy status of the room. So this hotel has multiple smart rooms that, as you can call it, and each of these rooms that you can see, they have multiple sensors that measure each of these physical quantities, like a temperature, humidity, the presence of a person, etc. And each of these sensors in a room would then get connected to a control unit that aggregates this information from various different sensors. And these sensors are typically very low-power devices, right, with limited capacity, and they can transmit data only up to a certain bandwidth. So that's where this control unit comes into picture, because it's slightly more powerful than these sensors, and they can perform slightly more complicated operations as well. Like, for example, they can help you make localized decisions that involves data from one sensor and, in turn, control another actuator as well. In turn, these control units are then connected to a gateway, which is responsible for the communication between the devices and the cloud services. And the cloud services can act on the data that is received from these sensors, and they can also provide commands to the actuators based on some decision-making that happens within these services. And as your application evolves, handling these business logic and data processing on the cloud allows you to have more control to build out different kinds of applications. Now, the cloud services are basically services that are exposing APIs that can be consumed by multiple user-facing applications. And it can be for different channels, like you could have a desktop application, you could have a mobile application, and things like that. So, for example, in our situation, we had a web app that would assist a hotel maintenance staff if there's any anomaly in the sensor data. And there was a mobile app for guests that were checking into the hotels. And both of them consumed APIs from the same IoT cloud platform. So considering this application as one of the examples, What makes, we like to talk about what makes this IoT platform different from other kinds of API platforms, right? How is it different from a regular CRUD application? From our experience, we've seen these are the key aspects to be considered while building the IoT platform. And we'll walk you through each one of them. The first one that I'd like to talk about is context mapping. So what's context mapping, right? In the use case that I just described, there are so many sensors that are transmitting data from different rooms and different floors. So when I receive the data on the cloud, I should be able to tell which part of the building a particular data came from, right? So in order to be able to associate this data to the corresponding source, it is important to have this translation of the building context into our services or the cloud API platform. Like, for example, how many floors are present, what are the different rooms, which are the rooms present on which floors, and things like that. And using this information and knowing each of the attributes for the devices, you can easily derive a relation between the device and the location within your services itself. And then you can have use cases like, hey, room 101 is unoccupied, but the light is turned on. So maybe let's send a command to switch off the light. Right, so all this is possible only if you know the context of the building and where your devices are located. Now, how do you actually model a physical device in the IoT platform into your services? That's where device representation models are key for us. And Archana will walk us through a couple of them.
Cool. Thanks, Pooja. So like Pooja mentioned, one of the key aspects that sets apart an IoT platform, an IoT software platform from a normal platform, would be the various different ways in which we can model and represent our devices on the cloud, and how each of these ways could have an impact on how efficient and effective we are in processing the data. So the project that Pooja mentioned that she and I worked on, we had the opportunity to test out some of these models. And the third one, which is the OCF model, we tried out like a proof of concept with it. So these are the three things that I'll be talking to you about today. So the first one is called the ACTA model. So a lot of you might already be familiar with this. This is based on something called as the ACTA model, or the reliable ACTA model. So the whole idea of this ACTA model is that each device in the IoT ecosystem is modeled as an actor. And when we say it's an actor, what does that mean? So an actor is nothing but a really long running process. And each actor, each one is a concurrent process, but each actor has its own context that it individually maintains. And so each actor also has a message queue that it can use to communicate with each other. And each actor has the capability to contain its own state and maintain it within itself. So an example would be what we have on the right side here. So this is an example of a hierarchy of a relationship between different types of actors. So we start with a control unit actor, which is sort of the gateway or the unit that manages all the devices under it. And under this, it's got four actors that are mapped to it. And this control unit actor can communicate with each one of these actors by dropping a message onto the queue here, and vice versa. So when there is a message that's dropped into this actor's queue, this actor would actually come to life. So it's a long running process. It would sleep when there are no messages. And when there is a message that's dropped in, it would come to life. It would process the message. And maybe by processing the message, there is a change in the state of this particular device. So it computes a new state, stores the new state within a local state, a state system somewhere, and then it goes to sleep again. So in the example that we implemented, we primarily use the Azure stack. And so we use the Cosmos DB to persist this actor state onto the database, which can then be easily retrieved whenever the actor comes alive again. So what we have here is another representation of the hierarchy of actors. So this example actually takes it a step ahead. So in the previous case, what we saw was different devices getting modeled as actors. But here, if you see, even different entities like the hotel that the device is situated in, or the floor or the room that the device is actually located in, can also be modeled as an actor. While this is not really mandatory or necessary, it's just an interesting way to extend the concept. And you can actually see how the hierarchy of the relationship flows into place. So you've got a couple of devices here. Each of these devices belong to a room, the rooms belong to a floor, and so on and so forth. So you can see how the hierarchy is modeled here. And what we have here is just a JSON representation of how this would be represented. And this is actually the state that would get persisted and retrieved each time the actor object actor process awakens or goes to sleep. So that's the first example. The second one that we wanted to talk about is called as a device twin. So if you're familiar with Azure, this is a concept that Azure provides called as a device twin, which is just a representation of the physical device in a virtual state. So it's a representation of the physical device on the cloud. If you're familiar with AWS, then this is very similar to the concept of shadow devices. So essentially what this gives us is a set of properties and ways to represent a device effectively. So if you look at what we have here, a device twin has a few standard properties. So there's something called as tags, and tags are nothing but just ways for us to represent metadata of the devices, which can then be read by the backend system or the device software to understand specific metadata details related to the device. But it also has a couple of properties called as desired properties and reported properties. So the way this works is, so let's take an example of a thermostat. The thermostat is recording the current temperature in the room. And let's say it's 23 degrees Celsius. So the reported property would be 23 degrees Celsius for the device. Now let's say I want to reduce the temperature. I send in a command through the API to the cloud. And so this command would then say, set the desired property to 21 degrees Celsius. So when this happens, the system understands that there is a difference between the desired property and the reported property. And so this gets communicated with the actual physical device, which then understands that there is a difference between these two properties. So it changes the state of the device, the physical device, so that these two become the same. And then it reports back the acknowledgement and the change state back to the cloud. Another example is, the actual temperature can be changed by a lot of physical factors as well. Somebody turns up the aircon or turns up the heater. So the thermostat detects a change in the temperature and sees that the temperature has actually physically gone down to 21. This is not initiated by the user via software system. When that happens, the device actually reports back to the cloud saying there is a change in the reported property, and the device twin records it on the cloud. So the advantage is that when the user uses their phone, for example, to see what's the latest temperature, that call doesn't have to go all the way to the physical device. Instead, the system just returns the data back from the cloud because it already has the latest state. So what we have here is a JSON representation of this. It's very similar to what I explained, but you can see that the properties are represented here as desired and reported, and this would change based on how you want to manipulate the state of the device. The last device representation model that we are going to look at is called as the OCF model, or the Open Connectivity Foundation model. So the Open Connectivity Foundation is a consortium of different companies that have come together to create a common specification, which can then encourage the adaptability of devices from different manufacturers and different brands into one ecosystem. So this is just to encourage interoperability and create shared ecosystems that do not restrict end users from adopting a new device or a new type of device just because it's not interoperable. So the OCF primarily works on the basic definition of a thing, which is this. So it says that any object, anything, an IoT thing can be represented with two sets of components. So one is called as the resources, which are nothing but properties of the device, which represent its state. So for a light bulb, this could be something like, what is its state? Is it on or off? What is the dimming setting? And what is the brightness setting? And then we have something called as functions, which take in parameters and which are just operations, which can then operate on this thing to change its state. So you can have functions which can change the state of the switch to on or off, or change the dimming level or set the brightness, for example. So how does this work? The specification actually says it's a layered approach. So we start with some basic components that are really important for any IoT device, which include connectivity, networking, and transport layers. On top of it, we have a basic framework which talks about different things like addressing CRUD and notification options, device discovery, device management, messaging. All of these are basically very common for an IoT device, irrespective of which domain it operates in. So that's the next layer of the framework. Then the layer above, it talks about the vertical domain to which this device belongs. So you could have capabilities which are related to a smart home device, if that's the industry that you're building in, or it could be health or industrial, or it could be a totally different thing related to cars, smart cars or whatever. So you have some very specific domain specific operations here in this layer. On top of which we overlay the OCF models that we just saw, and then you have the application layer on top. And then security is like an orthogonal component which runs across all these layers. And so OCF recommends that by adapting the specification, you can build device models that can interoperate with different manufacturers and providers. So this is like a very fast evolving subject. So this is the latest version of the specification, but it keeps changing very often. So you can check out the OCF site here to get more details about this. So moving on, one other concept about IoT devices that is very different from normal ecosystems is the scale at which these devices operate. So the number of edge devices and the volume of data and the frequency of data that's being transmitted. So I'll now hand over to Pooja to talk about the scale of IoT devices and how we handle scale at this massive level.
Thanks, Archana. Like Archana said, right, the scale at which the IoT platforms operate is completely different to your regular platform. And that's one consideration that makes this slightly different to the regular CRUD applications. According to a Gartner report, there'll be like about 25 billion connected things by 2025. And that's just huge, right? And the sheer volume of the a number of devices, it just means that there is a massive amount of data incoming based on the frequency with which these devices are transmitting data. To give an example, in our use case, we had devices that used to ping us every 5 minutes to inform us of their keep alive status. So they used to ping us every 5 minutes and report what their health condition is. And our IoT platforms should be built to obviously handle this kind of scale and volume. And depending on the criticality of your application, the data that you might receive might have to be processed at different frequencies, right? For example, if it's a security or a health-related application where the incoming signal from the device signifies a sensor being tripped, then you would have to raise an alarm immediately. I don't think you can wait for taking an action on such critical applications. If it were something like a dashboard of energy consumption, which is one of the use cases that we worked on, where there is marginal delay acceptable, it's okay to process data a little bit later. And since there's no critical impact on the users directly. So Archana, if you can move on to the next slide. In order to deal with this massive volumes of data, we had these four measures that we used. The first one was the gateway, because this was a point of contact between the devices and the cloud. This solution was deployed on Azure for us. So we used Azure's IoT Hub that comes with high availability and built-in APIs for things like device registration. The gateway basically allows for a bidirectional communication between the devices and the cloud. And when I say bidirectional, the sensors and the end devices can send data to the cloud. And in return, the services can make some decision for you and send the data or the command back to these devices. It would also perform some data aggregation from devices that are communicating with different protocols. So that was a gateway. We also had a telemetry service that would continuously accept data and process it. This is basically responsible for tracking the keep alive status of the devices because the volume of pings were really, really high. This was the service that would receive the maximum data and hence our first point of action if we had to scale our services. We also had a time series database to partition data into chunks for handling the loads that were incoming. And this was used to capture the change in state of the devices over a period of time. So this facilitated easy data writes and time was treated as the first class citizen. And hence you could perform any timely actions that were required based on the criticality of the applications. The last thing we did was to maintain a cache for quick access, where if you needed any pre-processing that needed to happen, that was performed here. And this cache had a configurable update. And whenever we needed data to be swapped out, that was performed by an offline processor. So what can be cached here and what cannot be depends upon the security requirements and the data that you are caching itself. So that brings me to the next point of security. Like Archana was mentioning, security is a cross-cutting concern. It spans the different layers that we spoke about. A lot of consumers find it hard to trust IoT applications given the sensitivity of the data that gets collected. One vulnerable device in the entire ecosystem allows an attacker to get access to the entire system itself, right? So that's extremely critical that you protect your devices. For example, there are simple things like changing your the default username and password of your Wi-Fi systems. If you can keep these simple things in mind, then that will prevent a lot of attacks coming into play. Like, for example, consider the temperature sensor that I mentioned earlier. The rooms in the hotel had to control and monitor the temperature changes. So in order for the temperature sensor to gain internet access, it was obviously required that it connected to a local network. If Wi-Fi is used, then there are outside attackers who can have an entry point into the entire system. And once they're in, they can make the sensor send any data that they wish. And a simple thing like missing out to implement a security protocol on a temperature sensor is enough to give attackers a segue into hacking your entire system. To mitigate some of these risks, we put in place a few measures. We put in access controls to control the devices as well as the APIs. For example, you wouldn't want guests of one room trying to change temperature of another room, right? That's an access control that you need to put in. We also had two-factor authentication for our devices to verify the integrity of the users. And in order to ensure data confidentiality during storage, we did encryption of data. And we only stored absolutely what's required and nothing more, nothing less. Confidentiality is also important when you're transferring data between the different layers. So you need to ensure that there are the right kind of protocols that are used when you're communicating data between the services as well. And the last thing was to have firmware updates to patch any vulnerabilities that might be discovered over the course of time. And how we did that, Archana will talk about it in the next couple of slides.
Sure. Thanks, Pooja. Before we move on to the firmware vulnerabilities and the patch updates, though, I just wanted to share an example of two-factor authorization that we did for our specific use case. So we built a security application that could actually monitor your home and allow the user to remotely monitor their home using their mobile device or on the website. So this was supposed to be built as a DIY application, so the user can actually buy the hardware off the shelf, then use the mobile app to set it up themselves. So one way we had to ensure that the actual physical device was being set up by the same user who was also setting up the mobile app was by using a form of two-factor auth using QR code scanning. So what we did was on the app, the user could generate a QR code, which then got scanned by the camera of the hardware device. And then both these devices would connect to the internet to send their respective codes to the cloud, which would then reconcile to make sure that the app is being used and the hardware is being set up by the same user, thus ensuring that there is no scope for it being tampered by anybody from the outside. So this is an example of how we implemented security for a specific use case. Obviously, a lot of this needs to be done based on a case-by-case basis. So moving on to the last item, which is patch updates and how do we ensure that our devices are ready to receive these updates? It brings us to a really critical question, which is how do we do CI/CD across and all the devices and software components in an IoT ecosystem? So for most software applications, CI/CD has sort of become second nature to us. We always design our systems in such a way that we can upgrade them and publish the upgrades at any time that we want. it becomes really hard when it is a physical device which could be geographically located anywhere with or without an internet connection. So one of the key things that we build into the system right from the start is its capability to have on-the-air updates, over-the-air updates, and also to have really graceful upgrades. There could be a lot of complexity caused by version updates, protocol changes, which is why it is really key for the upgrades to be graceful and to have backward compatibility when it is not a critical upgrade or a patch upgrade. So one of the ways we implemented this, and this is not like the most ideal way, is our gateway that we actually physically distributed to our users' homes was actually a pretty powerful device. It was almost running a web server. So we actually made it such that it had the capability to check for version upgrades. And if there was a version upgrade available, it could download the next version of the firmware, run a series of automated tests to ensure that its physical capabilities and the upgrade were compatible with each other. And only when those tests pass, it would switch over to the new version of the firmware. And if the test did not pass, then it would stick to the old version. Now, this is not a model that could work everywhere, but this is just one thing that we tried and worked for our application. So it's just an interesting question to leave you all with. How do we ensure that CI/CD is made applicable even to an IoT ecosystem? And finally,
we're just running a little bit out of time. Okay. So there's so much in this. I love how you a minute ago you were just talking about one of the examples from security architecture and giving an example. That was perfect timing. Someone in the chat was actually asking for a use case example. So you're really fulfilling our viewers' needs here. There is another question. What kind of tools are you using for auto deployment to devices?
So for the firmware code, we just use normal CI/CD pipelines using Jenkins. But for the actual version upgrade, it was built into the application logic at the firmware level, where it would just download the package and do an upgrade within itself. So the firmware bit was handled by a separate team. So I don't think they used any tool specifically for this purpose.
Right. Okay, cool. Look, I'm glad you've put up the slide showing your contact details. If everyone could take a note or take a screenshot of those. We do need to wrap up so people can go to their networking and the expo. Just one quick question, Pooja, as well. So when you were describing the IoT case for the hotels, it seems like that sort of model is going to be more so super important now with COVID, as far as being able to measure levels of recycled air in spaces, all of that sort of alert. So your IoT architecture for responding to these sorts of new use cases will be really, do you expect that to grow over the next 6 months? Are you seeing that already?
Absolutely. I think that's a very good extension of the use case that we already built, right? Like it's a matter of what kind of sensors you would put at the end of the for example, in the rooms, right? Like you mentioned, to measure the levels of recycling and things, so that it's just a matter of hooking in the right sensors and getting in the right data. And this architecture is bound to scale to cater to any use case.
Right. And so it's sort of like a combination of that use case, which you've described, and then Archana, your context mapping and device mapping, where you actually lay it out and see how they're all connecting to each other. Fascinating. Great. Thanks for finishing up our section on the API architecture. We'll leave our viewers to head to the Partners Village now, and we'll be back here later on.